I myself have often fantasized about it would be amusing to read one's obituaries, but you can't do that. And then eventually I decided to write a play about this. And I think it's a very good play. It's a play that I've enjoyed very much. And it is, as I said, already come out in book form here in German, not yet in English. And there'll be the German premiere. This was only, Ego only was performed in London. It opened only last year. I wrote it a year and a half ago, less than 2 years ago. And it has only three characters. They were wonderful actors, particularly the woman actors, Leigh Zimmerman, a spectacular actress. And it did so well that my German agent, I don't have an agent in English, but I have one in German, managed to get not only a very good Austrian premiere, which will be next month, a month and a half, and I'm very much looking forward to it, but much more importantly, a huge German tour of 60 performances, which will start in January of next year, January, February, all over Germany, with a real German theatrical star. So I'm really looking forward to it. And the German radio has already published, has already broadcast a radio version, which I also prepared this. So it's a play that's moving in the right direction. It has not been performed yet in the United States. It's a very recent one. But in the play, I do that. I've managed, or the actors really managed to get, of course, the emotional things through even even better. And I learned a lot about myself in writing both the novel and the play. And there are hidden autobiographical things in there that I will never disclose, which are the sort of gaps that I talked about, because the gaps in autobiography are only of two kind. And that is why I think autobiography, or even what you're doing right now, mm-hmm. this type of interview, people better realize, the future viewers, and I want, say it for the record, and I don't want you to cut this, whatever else you cut, don't cut this. Don't believe everything you hear in this interview. Not because I am necessarily deliberately lying, but most likely inadvertently. That autobiography, and therefore this type of oral history, is automythology. It is automythology, because you are presenting yourself, and unless you're an utter masochist, you're trying to do it in some sort of favorable way, or at least semi-favorable way. I mean, even the worst autobiography, not worst written, it's one of the brilliantly written, but painful one, Erwin Chargraff's, and there's a man, if he were alive, you should have interviewed him, who died at age 99 just a couple of years ago. called Of Heracleitan Fire, a very pretentious title, but an extremely complex and sophisticated autobiography, very bitter one. Usually autobiographies are not that bitter, but still, there is some, there's a great deal of ego that's also presented. And you either have the unconscious filters that prevent you from saying certain things, and they are also the ones that convince you that certain things way back have happened a certain way, although, because you hoped they happened that way, but in fact they had, did not. And I will, this will be my next digression, I will give you a striking example in my own life of this, and I'm sure there are oodles of other examples. So therefore it may not necessarily be true, although you think it is true. Whoever is speaking, you in this case, even being I. So autobiography is automythology and a form of fiction. And I believe that the only real, true place where you can write real autobiography is unconsciously and in the guise of fiction. Because it's when you write fiction that you are God. Everything is possible to you. You can write anything you want to, and you can pretend to the public and to yourself that you made it up. And of course, in a way, you made up many things. But another way, you can say you can have not have made up anything if it comes out of your own mind. It's there the moment I've created it. And where did it come from? Well, it comes not just from neural connections. It comes from my past experience. And that is colored by whatever I am, whoever I am. But in addition, in autobiography, so these are the omissions which are unconscious ones. You can't help. They're inherent in the genre. But then the second kind of omission, these are the ones out of discretion or shame, particularly when you talk about still other living people and you do not feel entitled or shouldn't feel entitled to write about them. I feel that way about women in my life, for instance, that is no one's business but that woman and mine. And so therefore, there's already a huge area that one wouldn't address. In fiction, you can do that. And I find that I'm doing this all the time. But I don't provide anyone with a Rosetta Stone to Carl Djerassi, because I put myself, I mean, segments of me or certain events and so on, in so many different persons and events, and sometimes in certain female characters, in fact, perhaps even more in female than in male characters, deliberately so, to mislead the reader or the nosy the nosy person who wants to find out something about Carl Djerassi that he's not disclosing and thinks correctly that it's somewhere in the novel. But it's one thing to think so, it's another thing to find it. And I will not provide you with that key, obviously, and never have before, and I'm sure will not otherwise.